You know, we should know each other as we are going to be attending a 2 hours online session. So we should know each other, right? It's important. Okay. So first of all, a big thank you for all of you to come in. You're giving your Sunday evening, which is a most critical family time, down to this workshop. So that's fantastic. Right now, let's explain what's the object of ML123. I will be making you do some hands-on work. Obviously, those hands-on work can only be done by those who are probably having some softwares installed on their PC. But for the rest, trust me, you would be able to do a complete hands-on of what I have done post the session. As once the session is over, you would know what has to be done, how it has to be done, and you'll have all the code samples with you. And with that code samples, you would easily be able to perform each and every step. But there is a complete detailed notebook calling Deploy Using Streamlit, a simple case study. Of course, the major focus is on a third part, which is called deployment, not on the first part of 1 and 2. Although you will get introduced to 1 and 2, because without making an ML model, that is step 1 and 2, you really cannot deploy it, right? So to deploy it, we need the ML model in place. Now, question is, how do I get across this entire workspace which has this particular notebook ML123. To be very honest, I'm going to share this with you right now. That is a first point. But apart from that, in this notebook, you would see that there is a drive link. You can notice there is a drive link here. And this drive link is also given at this particular point where I'm taking you right now, and I'm expecting all of you to download the data from there. I'm typing datascience.swinconsultants.com. In datascience.swinconsultants.com, I am looking at the section called ML. You can see that there is a tab called ML. I click on it. I'll just go full screen for a minute. I would share this with all of you. So I repeat once again, I have gone to the link datascience.swinconsultants.com. I'm going on to section called ML. Under the section called ML, resources, point number 6 goes as ML123 workshop content here. This is a zip file. So once you download this, please unzip it. So I'm sharing this link, datascience.swinconsultants.com. Rest, I'm sure you know what has to be done. And friends, moment you have done the needful, that means you went to the link, you downloaded the zip file from this click called here, ML123 workshop content, you unzipped it. And after unzipping, you would see that you have unzipped it, and the name of the file is streamlit_testing, and it has got so many different files. Once you have done with this, please tell me already over the chat. I'm waiting. Anybody who is feeling confused can please quickly post a question over the chat. I'm sure one of us is definitely going to be able to answer it. Okay, so that's lots of people who are saying that they're ready. Fantastic. But still, there are many more to go. Yes.
I'm seeing 7 items.
Correct.
After that, how to, like, I can download option is there? Or?
Yeah, you're seeing 7 items. So I'll just show you on my screen once. Once you have gone to this link, you have to click on download to download the whole repository. So there is a button on the top right corner called download. You just download this. You'll see a Streamlit testing, and you'll unzip it. And once you unzip it, it's going to be looking like this.
Oh.
You'll see the 7.5. That's it. That's just keep that ready. That's it. Right, I believe most of you have downloaded an entire zip file and unzipped it. So, you know, that was important because, you know, one session starts and I'm in full swing because 2 hours webinars are like, they're like crash courses of certain things. So you're doing a crash course in ML 1, 2, 3. So, you know, I don't want you to miss out things. So that, you know, you have the whole repository with you safe and sound on your PC. Okay, right. So friends, now with the objective, you know, I believe that most of you have done the needful. So now I can proceed ahead. A quick confirmation, friends, a quick confirmation. Is the screen visible clearly? You know, is the font size visible clearly? Yes or no? Yes? Oh, thank you. That means you're able to read the screen as well. It should not be too dull or too small. Okay. Now, friends, the reason I'm giving you the repository is I'm also going to give you this Colab notebook. I'm also going to share this Colab notebook with you, but maybe after a few minutes. So let's first get a complete overview of what all we are going to do from now on in next 1 hour, 45 minutes. What intensive hands-on work are you and I going to do? Let's get that first a hang of it. I'm going to first introduce to you a deployment environment called Streamlit. Right? So what's Streamlit all about? I'm not speaking anything. I'm just showing you their homepage. It says Streamlit is an open source Python library that makes it easy to create and share beautiful custom web apps, that means web applications, for machine learning and data science. Okay, cool. It needs minimum Python 3.6 and above installed on your PC. That is the reason that most of you may not be able to do this practicals along with me, but you need to see what I'm doing. Otherwise, you can't do it. And the video recorded session would definitely, we will try our level best. Although webinars are not, we are not allowed to record the webinars. But yes, if I'm able to share the recording, if I get the permissions from the management, then I would definitely share the recording of this 2 hours webinar with all of you so that post the session, all of you can perform the way I was doing right now. But some of you, not some of you, in fact, like most of you, 50% of you who have either been our students for Masters in Data Science program or are ongoing students of Masters in Data Science program, I know you can do along with me because you have all your resources on your PC. Great. So there is a need to install Python and there is a need to pip install Streamlit, etc., etc. So basically, what Streamlit allows you to do is it allows you to, I'll just take you to the home page. It allows you to basically create a web application, a website. So they claim that they're the fastest way to build and share data apps. Streamlit, of course, is paid for the teams. That means for commercial use, for offices, it's paid. And it goes so simple. You write in Python, import Streamlit as ST, and you can actually create a web application. So there is no need to code in HTML5, in CSS3, or in JavaScript. Usually what would happen is you would have to actually code the things in a HTML5 or CSS3 or JavaScript to actually create a web application. And only then would you able to, you know, actually make a web application. So, you know, this picturesque diagram can actually help you to understand that it allows you to deploy your application. Although deployment is a paid service from their side, but then we can demonstrate it as a free service on our own PC. Great. So they have given some steps here, and the best part about Streamlit is it allows you to make a magically simple API with just a few lines of code without you learning anything extra. If you know Python, that's it. Full stop there. You can actually create your API using Python. You can actually create a web app using Python. You haven't to learn a new language further. So it says adding a widget is the same as declaring a variable in Python. No need to write a backend, define routes the way we do it in Node.js, handle HTTP request, connect a front end, use HTML or CSS or JavaScript. So all this stuff out. We're just writing simple, straightforward, very readable code using Python. Streamlit has been into existence from last 2 years, and they are becoming exponentially popular in the last 2 years. Exponentially popular. Okay, and they have beautiful user interfaces, and of course they are also evolving. And deploy instantly. So deploying an app is like very straightforward, but only thing it requires basically a kind of you need to send them a request or invitation, and they allow you for a free invite to deploy the app for a short trial period of 3, 5, or 14 days, and accordingly then they try to sell you the Streamlit package. It's as I told you, they have to have a business model in place actually. Okay, so this is what Streamlit is. Now what I'm doing going to do next is, so we're going to get introduced to what Streamlit is. We just got introduced now. Then further we are going to see a file called gettingstarted.py, and this file is there in the zip file which is just downloaded right now. So gettingstarted.py, we are going to go through it to understand how to use Streamlit. Then we are going to quickly dirty our hands on a Data Explorer app which talks about Uber pickups in New York City. It talks about Uber pickups. It's actual data of Uber pickups. It's old actual data of Uber pickups and drops at New York City during a certain period of time of about a 1 year or 2 years data. So we're going to look at that data. And entire steps, the data as well as the entire steps to use this data is already given in the docs of Streamlit. So first I'm going to cover up the docs part of Streamlit. I'm not doing anything where my brains are going to be used. Nothing that comes from side of Swin Consultants or from side of Rocky Jaktian. Now, after you've got your hands dirty on the first and the second, which should take us approximately about 1 hour, that is getstarted.py and Data Explorer app. Trust me, in this 1 hour, you would know completely how Streamlit is used. Now, after that 1 hour or 1 hour, 10 minutes of session, you know how Streamlit is completely used. So probably by around 7:30, maximum 7:30, you're fully ready. And you can actually get up and go and tell to somebody, listen, aapne ML model banaya, give it to me, I'll deploy it for you. You will say that to somebody. Or probably you can say, I can demonstrate to you the ML model by making a web app for you. Now comes the next final step of deploying an ML model using Streamlit, that is to do ML 1-2-3. Where in the ML 1-2-3, we are going to define a problem. Imagine you are working for Policy Bazaar or PaisaBazaar.com, like a website, like a e-commerce company. And they have made a loan eligibility process web form. They have actually, you can, if you go to Policy Bazaar or PaisaBazaar.com, if you want a loan, you have to go to PaisaBazaar.com. And there are, of course, many other websites of ICICI Bank, of Kotak, etc., where you need to enter basic details about yourself on a to get a loan. So once a customer's details has been retrieved in online application form, can you instantly tell me, can your ML model, you means can your ML model instantly tell me, should he be given a loan or not? So that I don't want a human intervention. Can you instantly tell me, will you be getting a loan or not? And if you'll be getting a loan, how much amount of loan? So at least can you tell me yes or no for the loan? Forget the amount. So that's what we are going to basically be looking into. So moment you enter details in online application form, your ML model will get invoked behind the scenes. Nobody can see it. But you are going to know it. you will be knowing it because you're going to make the ML model, friends. So you're going to make the ML model, deploy it on the Streamlit, so nobody can see it, but the Streamlit is going to show you a sensible, good-looking user interface, right? So we're going to go with all these steps of loading the data, cleaning the data, formatting the data. Data is very simple. So the objective is ML 123. No? So 123 means it should be simple. We are going to take the columns from our data set, which we require, like the gender of the person, whether the person is married or not, what is his applicant's income, what is the loan amount he's trying to fetch, and what has been his past credit history, good or bad. Once this data is in place, we are going to use one of the algorithms called random forest classifier. Of course, this workshop doesn't allows us and doesn't permits, time also doesn't permit us to talk about all different classifiers and all different types of ML algorithms. That's a, probably a comprehensive course for about 30, 40, 50 hours. So one of the classifiers here is meant to classify data. So we're using that. And once we use that, we are looking at this model in place. Now, once this model has come in place, we move further. This is just basically testing the model using some test data. And once this is done, we are going to, you know, if we're satisfied with the output of the test data, we are going to actually save our model as a pickle file. Now, once you save your model as a pickle file, friends, you are then in a position of deploying the model. So from here, it's optional because, you know, if people really want to keep, you know, they want to stick to the Colab, they can use this. But if you don't want to do it on Colab, ideally, you shouldn't use Colab for this. You should use the command prompt for doing all this. So this classifier.pickle file is going to be actually loaded into Streamlit, and Streamlit is going to use this. Okay. So I know it's going to be a very comprehensive session. There's going to be like too much coming to you in the next 2 hours. So let's see. Session may extend by 5 minutes. I repeat, session may extend by 5 minutes. 8:05 or 8:10 ho sakta hai. Maximum, usse upar nahi. Okay. Now, friends, whenever you want to use Streamlit, we have to say pip install Streamlit and then say Streamlit hello to actually check whether Streamlit is really running or not. Let's take an example. Suppose if I say Streamlit hello and I press enter. So this is my command prompt where I have set my path to Python, where Python is loaded on my PC. So all the people who know to run Python programs on their PC, they can actually turn on their command prompt and type, or, you know, if you want, I can punch this to you. I will be giving you the Colab notebook, but not instantly. Patience for this. If I give you too many things, then you will end up getting confused. Okay, so what has happened right now? To be very honest, what's happened right now is it's trying to actually open a browser window because it has launched a Hello World application. It takes a little time to actually start for the first time, so don't worry on that. And it says that the app is the local URL. You can check the app on localhost 8501. Or this is the IP address of my PC, 192.168.43.98:8501. Streamlit always runs on 8501 port number. Just to check it out, I'll type localhost 8501. Let me see what's happening. Oh, wow. This is opened up. You say, what is this? This is actually a web page. This is a Hello World web page of Streamlit, which is just got running in front of you. Okay, this indicates that it's saying welcome to Streamlit, and it has got given us some links, as you could see here. I'll go full screen. This is giving you some links for us to scan through. Okay, so anybody who could do this,
yeah. I went to my Python. Mm-hmm. So after that, how do I get the program files?
All right. So what's your good name?
My name is Ravi Kumar.
Ravi Kumar, I wouldn't be able to help you by any chance on this because this is a webinar, you know. So if you know it, you'll have to go along with it. So probably our training programs can help you with that kind of one-to-one this thing. You know, so if you have it, you'll probably do it. If not, then you will have to watch the video later on and probably do it.
Sure.
Right. Yeah. Sure. So, friends, what I did right now, I'll repeat it once again. I typed StreamNit hello, as you could see. And when you type StreamNit hello, it's going to start the application on a browser. And it says you can look at the application on localhost 8501. And if you want to end the application, you will say Control C. I repeat, you will say Control C. Control C will stop the web app. It will stop the web server called StreamNit. Okay, I'll clear my screen. Okay, so we have tested that this is working. We've tested this. I'll close this. Oh, okay, let this be open because we are going to try different applications of StreamNit. Right, I'm not watching the chat, huh? Please notice on my screen, I'm not able to see the chat as of right now. Okay, now, how do you use StreamNit for your ML model? Very simple. To use StreamNit as a front end web app to test your ML model, open a new Python file. Okay. Import StreamNit and write some code, which we're going to see now. Run the file like this. Write StreamNit, the word run, and the name of the file. Obviously, many of you would feel the same. Theek hai, Rocky, how to do this? Now to do this, we have a file called gettingstarted.py, which is completely coded and available in the zip folder which you downloaded. Let me show you that. This is a zip folder you downloaded. Okay, and majority of you said that, majority of you mentioned to me that you have unzipped this particular file. So I'm going on to the file called getting started. So all those people who have Python installed on their PC and they know how to run a hello world program in Python, I'm not expecting much, right? Am I? So if you know how to run a Python, and please remember this, this is a piece of advice I would like to give to each and every individual. You're listening this from the horse's mouth. You're listening to a person who has been into training and content development over the last 21 years. So with 21 years of experience and with dedicated 4 years being in data science, AI, into project consultancy, into training, into content development for the best of the tech companies in the world, I would like to give you small advice. Don't jump things. You know, you have to ensure that your hands-on with Python is very strong. Otherwise, forget data science, forget AI, forget ML. You will crash. You will crash land on your face. If your Python and databases, that is SQL, and your statistics, three things, Python, stats, and SQL. If it's not strong, you're not going to go long way in data science. You won't go long way in ML or data or deep learning, nothing. You cannot sustain in this field. You will probably, even if you get hired as a data scientist, you'll be fired in the next 1 year. So people who are new to this field get excited about the salary of this field, but they do not know what is the stress the field demands from you. What is the kind of work culture the field demands from you? It's very hectic. Trust me. I've been into this field from last dedicated from in and out for last 4 years. So I know what kind of skill this field demands from you. You know, and to be in this field, business analytics, data analytics is different. That's very light. But when you talk about data scientist or ML engineer or AI engineer, oh my goodness, you need to have your software engineering and your coding skills completely in place, absolutely in place. In fact, it should be very sharp and very good. Okay, cool. So friends, let's have a look. This entire example is given step by step. I've not done anything, as I told you. Getting started is taken from the docs. So I'm sharing this docs links. It's there in your file also, right? I'm sharing this with you now. Have a look. I'll open it in front of you. It's just getting started. The easiest way to learn how to use StreamNet is to try things yourself. So all those people who know how to run a simple Python program will please run this along with me. Okay, it says create a new Python file named firstapp.py. You can give any name of your choice here. You can give any name of your choice, or you can directly use the file which I have given to you. Okay, so let's see this. Now I'm going to run in small intervals, and after every 2 or 3 minutes I'm going to pause and I will be happy to look. So out of how many of our participants have come into the workshop ML123 right now, even if 5 people executed along with me, I'll be more than happy. Rest are of course learning, you know. So if you're comfortable to do multitasking, please do it. So Streamlit allows you to create interactive app for your data. So how do you go about? You will code, you will be able to view what you have coded, and you will repeat your steps. A 3-step process. Code, view, repeat. Simple. So show it to us. I will. I have done import Streamlit as ST, import NumPy and pandas. Please remember, to run any Streamlit file, you will not write Python, you are going to write Streamlit. Then the command called run and the name of the file. So if your file's name is first, you will name it as, let's say, first.py, you will run first.py, whatever name you have given. Okay, now it says I'm adding a title to the web application. Okay, so let me do one thing. Let me cut out from the step 4, step 5, step 6, step 7. Let me cut all this up till this point. Let me cut it. Okay, and dump it into some dummy file here. You know, all of you can do that, no? You can cut everything and keep it in one dummy file, except step 1, 2 is just a comment, and step 3. Okay, see what I'm doing, and then all of you are expected to do it. You can use the same file. You can see I've gone to my command prompt. I've written streamlit run getting started.py. Please have patience. It's going to start. See, so my path is not valid. I have to give a valid path. So a little patience on this. I need to find the path of this on my PC. Full file path to clipboard. Please have a look, friends, what I'm doing. So my command prompt path is up to Python. My command prompt path is up to Python. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pick up everything after Python. So all this stuff is going to get picked up. This is the actual path of my getting started for py file. So I'll go here onto my command prompt, type streamlit run, paste the whole path and wait for him to run it. 30 seconds, you'll have to please wait. Oh, great. It says starting localhost. It's going to start in another browser, actually, starting in an Avast browser, which I don't want to see. I'll just minimize this. And I'll go to my Chrome browser, because opening too many browsers while sharing is a little difficult, right? See this. I've just localhost 8501. You'll say, hey, what is this? I'm just seeing a title. My first app. This is a title. Because our code is only containing that, no? See, our code said streamlit.title. So you see my first app coming up. Simple. Okay, now watch me with another step, and then I'm going to give you time to do it yourself. I'm adding my step 4. What my step 4 does is, it's using a function called streamlit.write. Now write is a super duper function. It's like a Spider-Man. He can do a lot of things. So st.write is, here's our first attempt at using, so I'm just giving some text string matter to write, then I'm also making him write a data frame. Wow. So you can make him write anything. The write function can draw a table for you, it can draw some figures, it can print data frames, it can print text for you, it can do everything for you, in short. So let's see this. I've just saved this code here. I just saved KS code. And the option came here because it sends that the file has got changed. Do you want to rerun it? Either you say rerun it or you say always rerun. Your choice. I'll say always rerun. Wow. Now this is quite beautiful. No HTML used by me, friends. One line code. So this text came up. This data frame came up. Okay. Now I'm waiting for all of you. How many of you are coding along with me? Please should try doing this. Great. Abhishek Lalwani and Vispita Nagrale. I know both of them are from Pune. And both have said that, yes, they have done this much. Waiting for others. Fantastic. I'm still going to wait for another 1 minute for more acknowledgements to come in. Please try. It's not difficult. Everything is given to you. You have to only ensure that the paths in your PCs are proper. Now, if anybody doesn't know how to set the path or how to run a Python program, then that means there's a lot of more learning that needs to be done. And webinars are not the way to learn. Webinars is a way to get introduced to understand what is data science and what is ML. You know, webinars will only teach you that. A 7 months, 8 months, or a 10 months course is going to teach you what data science or machine learning is. Well, I see some people acknowledging over the chat that they have done this much. Great. So people who are executing along can actually move even further along with me. I'll minimize the chats to see my further code. Now I'm picking up step 5 and step 6. I'm going to pick up step 5 and step 6. Please have a look at step 5. Step 5 says I'm going to draw a line chart. So friends, what I have done is, we have actually basically made a data frame, as you could see, of some random data. I have generated 20 random values in 3 columns. 20 random values in 3 columns. Column names are A, B, and C. So start data is going to show that random values which have got generated by the random function, and streamlit.line_chart function, which is a predefined function in Streamlit, is going to draw a line chart for you. So no matplotlib, no headache, nothing, is going to draw a line chart for you. Wow, this is like too super simple. Next, I'm plotting a map of Mumbai, and we are going to plot 50 random points over it. I'm going to plot 50 random points over it. Let's have a look. So we have a data frame. In this data frame, I've generated actually, not 50. I'm plotting 40 random points over it. So what we are doing exactly is, I'm generating random 40 points. And this over here, this particular point over here, 19.07 and 72.877, this is actually the lat and long of Mumbai. So I'm generating 40 random points around Mumbai. If you're wondering what are this 50-50, basically when you generate points, you know, you need to scale them. So I'm divided by 50-50 to scale the values. Okay. And sc.map function of Streamlit would draw a map for you. Okay, Rocky G, how it's going to look like? It's going to look like this. Have a look, your app is already ran. Moment I save my program, my app will run here. Okay, so first you see that 20 random values were generated for the columns A, B, and C. As you could see here, 20 random values generated from 0 to 19, right? For columns A, B, C. These random values have got plotted here, see? Yep, you can see them here. So you can see axis A, B, and C. So 3 values randomly got plotted, 20 values, see the bottom, 0 to 19, 20 values got plotted. Cool. Then what's this? This is the map. Anybody who's from Mumbai, they will know this is a map of Mumbai. So you can see places like Powai, then Chakala, DN Nagar, Bandra, Wadala, Matunga, Syne, etc., etc. Right? So this gives you an indication that that's the map which has got drawn here for a given lat and long. If you wish to change the lat and long, you can actually, it's very easy. You can go here and probably say lat and or long for which place do you want. You decide. So you say Pune. So I'm trying to find what is the lat and long for Pune, Chinchwad as a place. So that's going to be 18.628 and 73.7997. It's northeast. So you need to pick up this coordinates from here, as you're seeing on my screen, friends. Dump the coordinates here in my code. I repeat, you pick up the coordinates you want. I'll do this for you. just remove this north and east, which is not needed. Just the coordinates are needed. So we need, this is the lat part, latitude, and this is the longitude part for a place called Pune, Chinchwad. Right, so I've just saved this here. I'm just going over the web page. Streamlit is a little sluggish, huh? it's a little slow. Okay, so these are the places which are actually visible, you know. This is what is coming up. This is the old data and this is what is coming up. So if anybody is there from Pune out over here, and I know Abhishek and Vismita are there from Pune, maybe others also. If anybody is there from Pune, could you please verify, are these places going correct? Like Pimpri, Chinchwad, and then Pimpri, and yep. Tell me over the chat, yes, no, come on, quick. Yes, oh, great. Oh, Nisha Kabe is also from Pune, so she knows about this place, fantastic. Serena B also, yeah. Fantastic, thank you friends, thank you. So you can actually put your city, you know, wherever you are, Hyderabad, Bangalore, whichever place you are, or probably you can go even more narrower and you can see plotting a few points there. Okay, right, so I'm going to hold on for 2 minutes for all of you to do the same. Please do it. Please find your place of choice, dump the lat and longitude here, and see the map of that place with 40 random points coming over it. I'm going to hold on. If you have got any doubt coming up in your mind, please post it over the chat. Well, friends, I assume that most of you would have ran up till the step number 6. So what we are doing exactly is, so Poonam's question is very valid. Poonam, it goes this way that we are using a random function to generate 40 points, 40 random points across two columns, one for lat, one for long. We are scaling it, or we are dividing it by 50 so that the values become very small. Usually the random value generated, Poonam, are going to be between 0 and 1. Random value generated by random functions are always between 0 and 1, like 0.5, 0.6, you know, something like this. So those random values, if you divide it by 50, there will be, the values will become very small, no? Imagine 0.5 by 50, the values will become very small. So that minuscule value is being added to the lat and the long, so that keeping Pimpri, Chinchwad, or Pune, Chinchwad in focus, you are drifting geographically maybe a few kilometers on the right or a few kilometers on the left, just to give you an intuition. See, Poonam, what happens to, if this particular point called 18.6298, 73.7997, if it indicates some certain location, then 18.6299 and 73.7998, let's say 87 would indicate another location, but nearby to this location. So what we are doing is exactly is we're generating a random number, let's say 0.5, because values are going to be between 0 and 1. We're dividing it by 50 so that this value becomes very small. This value is going to probably, be quite small. It's going to be like 0.01. So we're adding 0.01 to the latitude. Now, obviously, if you add 0.01 to 18.6 to this 8, this value is going to be naturally 18.6398. So that's the reason we are able to get points which are around Pimpri-Chinchwad. Okay, that's what is the point here. So I hope step 6 is also clear to everyone. Now moving on to friends, I'm moving on to step 7. Only step 7. I'm moving on to step 7 and then I'll come to step 8. Please have a look at step 7. Step 7 says add interactivity with widgets. Use checkboxes to show hide data. Oh, interesting. Essay. It's very simple. ST is your streamlit. Dot checkbox is actually going to make a checkbox. And what you're doing exactly is you are having a data frame here in which you are making a data frame, but this data frame is going to actually be shown if this part goes true. Think about it, you know, so this entire code of line 48 onwards, line 48 se lekar up till line 52, this entire code is inside the if block, isn't it? It's inside the if block, and because it's inside the if block, therefore if you tick mark the checkbox, it will run this code. Why? Because if you tick mark the checkbox will go true. And therefore, this code runs. Have a look. Let's go back here to getting started page. I don't know any which way is run. Moment you save your code, this will run. See this. Show high data frame. This is a checkbox title. And if I click on the checkbox, I would see the data frame here. If I untick the checkbox, the data frame is going to go out. But you will say, how did it sense? Yeah, so whenever I check it, it runs the app. Look up on the top. Okay, look on the top. Keep your eyesight on the top right corner, huh, of my browser. Keep your eyesight here. See what happened. It says running. So the app was running. So web application. So anytime you make changes, it actually runs. If there is any web developer in my class right now, he or she would be definitely knowing that this is an Ajax application. StreamMeet is coded as an Ajax, a complex JavaScript Ajax application. So whenever you make some changes on the front end, it sends it to the server to run it and shows you the changes here on the screen. Okay, now I'm entering into the last step of my getting started code, which is step number 8. Let's see. Step 8 and 9 is of course quite similar. So look at this. Please have a look, friends. Step 8 says use a select box for options. It's very simple. So, you know, instead of I talking anything, I'll show you what a select box is. And then I'm also going to show you what is sidebar. You know, it's not always a good practice to show everything on the main screen. You can shift the certain things on the sidebar. The way you see it, the way you see menus on the website, same similarly, you can do it over here also. How do you share your app? I'll talk about it. Please give me a little time. Oh, wow. It looks nice. Yeah, what has happened by the way? Okay, what has happened by the way? First of all, look what has happened first. Which number do you like the best? This is a select box which has come. So whatever number you select will be shown here. So it says you selected 2. You selected 2. Why? Because you selected 2 here, no? What have you selected? You select 3 here. It will say you selected 3. So you're wondering, yeah, Rocky, how does you selected 11 came here? That's because of the sidebar. Notice. This is a sidebar here. So the sidebar, in my browser, It's not showing you the collapse button. Actually, there's a collapse button which comes here. This is not coming up properly. So if this is collapse button, actually collapses it. Again, if you come here, it collapses and open up here. That's because of the browser problem. That's not because of the streamlet. It's because of the browser. The browser is having some plugin installed, which is actually restricting its visibility. So which number do you like the best? I'll choose something, let's say 12 here. You would notice on my screen, notice here. See, you selected 12. This is called as a sidebar, you know, so you can do settings here in the sidebar and show the data on the main page accordingly. Whenever you don't want it, you can collapse the sidebar so that you can see the whole screen neatly. Okay, I want you all to run it right now. I'm waiting. So how many people could run up to step 9? You should say step 9 done. How many people could run up to step 9? Should say step 9 done. Great. So that's a lot of people who are executing along with me, and that's a true fun where you are able to actually experience it yourself. But then trust me, whatever I'm doing on my screen, your code is going to work irrespective of the configuration of the PC you're using. Our codes are going to 110% work. You just have to ensure that your Python is correctly installed. That's it. Nothing more. Okay. Now friends, if you wish to share your app, okay, after you have built your Streamlit app, it's time to share it, to show it to the world. Cool. Right now, what Streamlit is doing is, Streamlit sharing is currently invitation only. So you need to send an invitation. Don't worry, they won't charge you anything. Moment you request an invite, you will get a permission to share your app very quickly. So how will you do it? It works in three simple steps. You put your app in a public GitHub repo. So you just have a GitHub account and you dump your upload your files to GitHub. You'll get a URL. Make sure it should have a requirements.txt file. Sign into share.streamlit.io and click on the button called deploy an app. But to click over the button on deploy an app, they have to allow from your email ID. And you can send an invite or request an invite only once. एक बार आपने उनसे इनवाइट मांग लिया तो आपके ईमेल आईडी पर आपके ऑफिशियल ईमेल आईडी पर वापस से आपको इनवाइट फ्री का वो नहीं देंगे दे विल आस्क यू टू प्रॉब्ली अपग्रेड इनटू द पेड वर्जन ऑफ स्ट्रीमलेट ओके राइट सो वेरी वाइजली यूज द इनवाइट सो यू नो आई होप यू आर एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड आई हैव ऑब्वियसली कंज्यूम्ड माय इनवाइट सो दैट्स द रीजन आई कांट री आस्क फॉर इनवाइट सो ऑल द ईमेल आईडीज व्हिच आई हैव ऑलरेडी कंज्यूम्ड इट Okay, right, cool. But it's trust me, it's very simple. Kuch nahi karna hai aapko. Aapko khali ye teen steps follow karna hai. It's like a child's play. It goes very smoothly. Even if you get stuck somewhere, if you email to them, they are more than happy to help you. They will actually reply in the email, send you a short video of 1 or 2 minutes to show you the steps to click. But it's very simple. Okay, now, what? Let me go back to my notebook. So notebook is basically just a kind of a, you know, it's kind of a guideline for us ki kya kya hame karna hai in what sequence we have to do I'll share the notebook with you only when I reach to the point of problem definition not before it okay so let's see this now further now I want all of us to get our hands dirty on a data explorer app so if anybody here is in logistics in insurance in a banking sector in finance, in admin or operations, they would love this. usually people are into business analytics, they love this application. They say, yaar, must hai, I will use it for my own work also. Yes, you can. It's straightforward. Okay, so the steps for making this app is given on this link, docs.app. Creating a data explorer app, step-by-step process is given here. Trust me, step-by-step process. Nothing which I have to use my brains for. If I just follow the steps, I'll just share that link with you also. But for the time being, you can watch me what I am trying to show you. If you have reached this far, that means you have finished with gettingstarted.py. You've finished with that. Then I think we can actually make a complete app. So the first step is to create a new Python script called uberpickups.py. So if you notice, even Streamlit is not telling you to go ahead using Colab. Try to understand. Streamlit bhi aapko nahi keh raha hai ki aap Jupyter Notebooks ya Colab use kare. Wo keh raha hai ki you should use some kind of editor, some kind of an IDE, in which or a text editor, in which you can actually create an application and follow the step-by-step process which is given here. Okay, so first is to do the required imports, as you could see. Then every good app has a title. So obviously, like last time we added a title, we add a title here also. Then it says you run this app. Obviously, फिर कुछ नहीं दिखेगा, केवल title दिखेगा. Natural है ना, title ही खाली दिखेगा. Then it says fetch some data. Cool, we will do it. After fetching some data to fetch some data, he is giving us a function called load data, and he's also given us a URL for the year 2014 Uber pickups and drops. This is actual data. This is not dummy data. This is actual Uber raw data. It seems it's got uploaded on Amazon Web Services, and this data belongs to 2014. So they have given us this data. We are loading this data, doing some kind of little bit text cleaning, that is kind of lower casing things and converting the date column into proper date time format. Once data is loaded, I repeat, once data is loaded, we are printing on the screen loading data done. So how it goes? First it says a text called loading data. It will take time, maybe 30 seconds, 40 seconds. It will take that kind of time. We are calling the function load data. We are passing 10,000. That means we want only 10,000 records. The data set is huge. The data set is huge. It's having a few million records. That will take a long time to load. So we are loading only 10,000 rows of the data, making a data frame out of it. Once data frame of 10,000 rows is ready, we are saying loading data is got done. Cool. Perfect. There is a beautiful facility in Streamlit called caching. Yeah, why caching is required? Doesn't make sense to load data again and again. Like, you know, you make changes to your application, so every time you make changes to your application, your data will get loaded again and again. It's like stupidity. So every time you make some change in the application, it will reload the data. Data has not changed, my friend. This is 2021 going on. 2014 Uber have done pickups and drops is constant, no? So why do you want to load data again and again? Why do you want to waste your internet bandwidth? Why you want to waste your bytes of data? Bandwidth kyun waste karna hai? Haan, ye baat to sahi hai. Exactly. So whatever data has got loaded in your application, please save it on your hard disk or your SSD. So that's called caching. So Streamlit allows you to cache data. This actually ensures that when the application reruns, data will not be reloaded. Data which is already loaded in the past will be reused. This is like caching of the browser. So it makes a lot of sense. So we save the script and we are going to, okay, this is just trying to say this. You can just add one line that data loading is done using ST cache. That means data has got loaded from the cached data. Then this is explaining of how the caching works. It's simple and interesting for your self-reading. Then, if you notice, we are trying to draw a histogram. So a histogram is going to give me that in 24 hours of the entire day. Why binge 24? Because 24 hours in a day, the data which is given to you is giving you information of every minute by minute pickup. So from minutes you can pick up the hours, no? Right? If I say 7:02 par, you know the hour is 7. So I'm actually bringing data hourly, and for every hour of the day I want to plot how many pickups were done by Uber for the entire 24 hours of the day. Further, we are plotting the bar chart, and then we are trying to show, by using sc.map, we are trying to show the map of the New York City and the pickups done by Uber. Cool. How will this all stuff look like? Now let's put it to good use. You read a kind of blog article, right? Now let's put the steps to good use. कैसे करें रॉकी जी? अभी करते हैं, अभी हम करते हैं. बस ध्यान से मुझे देखिए, फिर मैं आपको समय दूंगा और आप लोग करोगे. फर्स्ट यू विल वॉच मी एंड देन आई एम गोइंग टू गिव यू टाइम फॉर यू डू इट. उबर पिकअप्स इज द नेम ऑफ द फाइल. कम ऑन, गिव मी अ क्विक थम्स अप. इज दिस फाइल इन योर वर्कस्पेस और नॉट? एंड आई एम होल्डिंग. प्लीज गो टू योर वर्कस्पेस एंड चेक, इज दिस फाइल? My friend Sukantu has just said yes. So it means it's very much there. And I'm very happy Sukantu could find time to come in. So many people are acknowledging that yes, they found the file uberpickups.py. Great. Now this time, please be responsive and please be interactive. Now you know a little bit of Streamlit. Now you will know even more of Streamlit. So I'm going to explain to you the working of this code logically as well as syntactically, or what each line of code is doing. But if I stop at a particular point and I wish to ask you a question, please don't feel shy. Be prompt in answering that question over the chat. Okay, so first let me run through with this code, and then I'm going to ask you some quick questions over the entire code. And I want maximum people to be interactive and participative over the chat. Usually in my sessions, in my regular ongoing sessions, I'm very interactive on audio. I tell people to come on audio and answer, but now because the crowd is huge, and probably you could have, that silence is not there, no, at times at your home. So if you come on audio, you may have some distractions into the batch. Okay, let's see. Import Streamlit, pandas and numpy. Some libraries have been imported. We are showing a title called Uber Pickups. Cool. Let me do one thing for all of you. Let me remove all this stuff. Sab kuch nikal ke tha. Kuch nahi hai wahan par. And if I wish to run this application, I need to go back to my command prompt. Oh, my old application is still running. Oh. Control C, please stop it. For backup, what I'm doing, you should not do this. Huh? Just keep watching what I'm doing. Watch this. So in my Uber pickups file, what I would do is, I'll take the path of this file as in my computer. For me, the path will start with Swain, which is a folder of my company, ML, subject's name ML, Streamlit testing, and uberpickups.py. So this is a place where the file is lying on my PC. Cool. Go here. Streamlit run. Please have a look. It's starting the application. Yes, it started the application, so let's minimize this. See what's come up. See for yourself. It's only title which has come up. Correct. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to add some more code to this. create a text element and let the reader know that data is loading. st.text is going to show whatever text you want to show. So this text loading data is being stored in a variable data load state. Cool. How many rows do you want to load? I wish to load 10,000 rows. Interesting. And once data is got loaded and has come into the data frame called data, I am changing the text. Data load state is actually a text box. This is the name of a text box. So data load state text box, we are changing its text to done blah blah. Okay. Oh, hold on. Hold on. I should have picked up something more also. Okay, I'll continue over here itself. What do you see next is the text part has got changed. Done. That means done. That is loading is done. Okay, now if you want to see that data, agar aapko data dekhna hai, so we are saying if st.checkbox, checkbox can either be true or false. If it is true, we are showing a kind of a header as raw data and we are showing the data. Data, see this one. This one. We are showing the data. Okay. Right. Now, let me show about this function. Load data function, which is just called at line number 22. Where is it defined? It's defined here. See? But before that, something more is also defined. I've just defined a variable called date underscore column, which holds this. This is a URL. URL means this is the path where your data set of Uber pickups is stored. It has got about 10 lakh records. It has got about 10 lakh records. So don't load the whole data. It will take a few minutes. Okay. So we are saying read CSV. We're reading the whole data. We have kept the number of rows as equal to whatever you have passed. How much I have passed? 10,000. So I have passed 10,000 records. So we are loading 10,000 rows into data frame. This kind of coding in Python does what? Understand, it's very simple. It says that we are creating a lambda expression. Whatever string you give me, my friends, I will convert it into lowercase. Koi bhi string agar aap mujhe doge, I will convert it into lowercase. This is what this fellow does. And whom are you converting to lowercase? Data frame, data is holding the data frame. Dot rename is renaming every column of the data frame into lowercase. We are converting the column of the data frame into lowercase. We'll say, so are you trying to say, Rocky, that columns are not in lowercase? They were not actually. They were not. So the columns are not in lowercase. That's the reason this function need to be used, so that we are able to convert all the column names into lowercase. Then what I'm doing is, if you notice, this variable date underscore column simply means date hyphen time. So we are basically ensuring, or rather converting ourselves, the data which is given in date hyphen time column into a date time object. And I'm sure you will say, are ye aap kyun kar rahe ho? Date time data has to be in date and time format. Who's saying was that? It is not stated on the page. It's not given on the web page that data is in perfect date time format. Aisa risk nahi le sakte. So whenever you have date time data, data could be stored as a string, could be stored as an object. So to be safe, please save. So what we're doing is, we are converting the data into date time object and restoring it back in the same place. Oh, so some little kind of data cleaning is what we have done. These three steps are doing basically little bit of data cleaning or data preprocessing. Okay, now watch this much. Itna hi code bas mein run kar raha hu, aap isko watch karo. Uber pickups, caching, everything is there. Yes, it's there. Let me save it. Here, Uber pickups has got saved. It's running. I don't know why it's not re-ran. It should have automatically ran. It's come. Always rerun. I click this. See what is coming up. It says loading data. See, it says loading data. This is the text file. Data is still loading. So then data got loaded in your application, in your web application. So it says done using ST cache. You want to see the raw data? Click this checkbox. See, it's going to load the raw data for you. Oh, wow. First thing. What's the first thing first? All the column names are in small case. There are only four column names. There are only four columns, I'm sorry. Date time, latitude, longitude, and the base station. Base station indicates the base from where the pickup has been done. So base station is actually a place where lots of cabs of Uber stand in the New York City. So New York is like a Bandra Kurla complex in Bombay. It's a very, very busy commercial place. So there are some certain kind of halting points made where Uber pickups or such kind of taxis can actually go and accumulate and stand. These are called base stations. They're like, they're kind of bus depots, kind of. So they're called taxi depots. So date time, latitude, longitude, etc. Now what you notice here is, just a second, let me rerun this once again. Let me show you once again. I click on show raw data because it is given in the if na, so you can see the whole data. Okay, and scrolling it here shows you that there are 10,000 records, as you could see, 0 to 4 times 9 is 10,000 records in place. Cool. Data has come to you, friends. Data aapke paas hai. And we are also very sure that all this data which is coming to us is not in string, not in object format. It is properly in date time format. We are safe. We played safe because of this code. We did the conversion, see, to date time. Now what? Something more to go. Now what we're doing is, we're trying to do some kind of analysis, which looks very interesting also. Have a look. What rows I've added? I've added a subheader, number of pickups by hour. I'm making a histogram to show you things. Now, how does the histogram looks? By the way, first of all, the histogram is drawn on hourly data. That means every hour, how many pickups have been done? So histogram will totally, it will add on each hour how many pickups have been done. It needs to be rerun. It didn't rerun on its own. Oh, it seems I didn't save it. Oh, my mistake. I didn't save the code after adding. Okay, now it's got saved. I'm sure it would have ran also. Yes, always rerun. Please have a look. This is your histogram. Your histogram is here. The histogram is saying that at the 0th hour, so out of the 10,000 records which is there, friends, have a look. So for this 10,000 records, you are having the pickup for every minute. See, on 1st September 2014, 12:01 a.m. Again, this was a 12:01 a.m. So you are having the pickups for every minute. And this is hourly count. So from 12:00 till 12:59 a.m. on 1st September, in that 1 hour range, how many pickups happened? So we are looking at basically the pickups happened on hourly basis of the data. So out of the 10,000 records, you are going to add all the pickups which happened in the night time at 12 a.m. in the night. And it seems there were 217 pickups happening. And I'm sure everyone can see the peak pickup times because most of the offices in the U.S. Start usually in the morning, like 8. 8 is the usual time they start at. So you can see that there are a lot of, the peak timing is like 7 a.m., 8 a.m., 9 a.m., 10 a.m. are this increasing. And when people are going to be kind of going back homes, it's like 5 o'clock. See, its peak is at 5, 17. 17 is 5 p.m. in the evening. That is a peak time when the Uber pickups are actually getting the peak most time. People want to go back home. So 4, 5, 6, 7 are the times when people want to go back home. So there's this, and it's going declining as it approaches the night. Okay. This is a histogram on hourly basis. Now, ye kaise aaya? What is this? Hold on. Then what we have done is, after plotting the histogram, please see very carefully, we are saying ST streamlet dot slider. To the slider, I am showing that please show me the hours ranging from 0 to 23 and default value keep it to 17. So the slider by default will be at the 17th position. So here the minimum hour is 0, maximum is 23 hours, and the default is at the 17th hour. Okay? Just a second, friends. It seems somebody is coming now. I don't know why. So late. Okay. So the hour to filter is this a date given? Whatever hour we are asking to filter, we are picking up the data only for that respective hour. Imagine if the hour to filter is 17. So obviously the hour to filter value will be 17. So what we're doing here is we are asking that from our data set, we only want those values whose R value is 17, that is 5 p.m. That becomes your new data. Maybe out of 10,000 records, you are filtering and getting 1,000 records. Those 1,000 records are going to be shown over the map. Have a look. You know why these dots are coming? These dots are indicating the pickups around New York City at the peak time 17. Let me change this to 9 a.m. At 9 a.m., so map of all pickups at 9 a.m. is this. This gives you the point of how the map pickups have been. Of course, you have an option to, you know, kind of move this map and amplify this map. Of course, all these things are possible, right? So you're getting me? So it becomes a very interactive thing, right? So instead of Uber pickups, you could probably have Swiggy or Flipkart drops, or you could probably have how many people have purchased and, you know, what has been the location centric of people purchasing, like. If I just say I want the statistics of how many people have purchased the OnePlus Nord 2 phone, which is latest, which has got launched on Amazon Prime on 26th and 27th. So how many people, so I would like to know whether it's Bombay or whether it's Pune or whether it's Hyderabad or Bangalore, where on which city has been the most concentration of people buying this phone. So it makes more sense for me to probably run digital ads and put hoardings in that place for the respective phone, isn't it or not? This gives you basically a way. If you have the data with you, you can actually plot over the map and understand where should you concentrate more on marketing? Where should you give more franchisee for OnePlus phones? Where should you open up your exclusive outlet of OnePlus? In Bangalore, in Hyderabad, in Bombay, or in Pune? You have to give me reasons, right? You cannot say that I'm going to open up an outlet because the city is big, so I will open it here. No, that's not going to work out. Okay? So there has to be reasons behind everything. Right. So this helps you in business analytics a lot. Trust me. Mapping and this kind of functionality. Now, I want all of you to answer a few questions of mine. But before that, it will be great fun if you try running this yourself. Okay. Janak has an input for me. Janak Chetri has an input for me. It's a clustering problem. Absolutely right. You're absolutely correct. It's a clustering problem which you have actually solved. Right. Good. But now I want you to try this code yourself, everyone. I'm halting for 2 minutes. Please try this code. If this code is tried, tell me Uber done on the chat. Tell me Uber done on the chat. Wow, that's fantastic. So many people who are aware about how to run a Python code, simply just a Python code. And obviously, if you're attending a webinar for ML 123, it is naturally expected that you know the Python coding language. Okay. So all the people who know how to run a Python code have been able to execute this particular assignment. Fantastic. Right. So I have some good questions for all of you to answer now. So now I'm expecting you to answer these questions. Right. My first question is this. These three steps, lowercasing, renaming of all the columns by using the rename function, you're lowercasing all the column names, and to play safe, to be safe, you are converting the date slash time column into a date time object. These three steps, what would you call them? Would you call them as machine learning steps, or would you call them as data cleaning and pre-processing steps? Your answer over the chat, please. Very nice. So many people answering itself as an acknowledgement that we are all doing good work. Great. It's called as data cleaning and data preparation step. Fantastic. Perfect. Next. When we write this particular annotation, @ means annotation. Annotation st.cache. Then your data will get loaded how many times? N number of times, because you run your code for N number of times, or only once? Wow. You guys are awesome. Only once. That's right. Absolutely right. The code is going to run only once. Data loading will happen only once. Good. Next. And the last question. When I am plotting a histogram, the histogram is aggregating. Aggregating means it is adding data day-wise or hour-wise. Is it adding the data day-wise or hour-wise? Very good. It is adding data hourly. Very good. Excellent. So friends, I'm closing the Uber pickups. I did mention to you at the start of the session, people who logged in on time, please remember I mentioned to you that by around little before 7:30, you should be able to finish and reach up till this point. The next final step is deploying the ML model which you make, not which Streamlit's docs is giving, which you make along with me. And that's what is ML123 all about. It's going to be very simple. Now things are going to go very simple because you know how to deploy the ML model. Okay. And for that reason, I definitely will be sharing this notebook along with you. But if you have been executing Colab notebooks, if you have been executing some, you know, kind of an ML model in the past, then you should follow along and do it. Otherwise, you know what is going to happen? Neither you will be able to follow me, nor you will be able to do it, because you are kind of struggling on time. I'm sharing the link of the Colab notebook over the group. I've just shared the link of the Colab notebook over the group. Poonam, it's already... Okay. Hold on. Let me reshare it. Friends, I have just reshared the link. Please use the second one. So when you open up this link, you would be having a button on my, as you can see on my screen, copy to drive. You will see on the top menu, copy to drive. Just click on copy to drive so that it gets saved on your drive. So this notebook of mine becomes yours, your notebook. It will get saved on your drive. How many people could save the Colab notebook to their drive? Should say yes, done, or just simply say done. Okay. That's quite a few people who got the Colab notebooks and they have shared it to their drive. Like everyone should have been able to do it by now. I move further, friends. First, please follow me along. I'm keeping myself on the full screen. I'm not watching the chats. Please follow me along. I'm humbly requesting each one. Don't do hush-hush. So what I'm doing first, friends, our problem definition is very simple. We have been given with some old loan eligibility data. We have been provided with some details of some old customers, some of them who were given loan and some of them who were not given loan. We want our ML model to study this data, like how a child before going to giving exams, he studies his notes, his guides, his from his teachers, from his parents, etc. He studies, right? He understands things. And only after he understands things, he can go and answer questions on the exam. Same thing. ML model is just like a small child. He says, you give me data to study first. Cool, we'll give you data. So from Google Colab, I'll just run this cell. Keep watching me very carefully, please. So by the way, when I run this cell, I have to load a data called train load data. This data file is already given in your zip folder, which you have unzipped about some time back. So I'm just going there. As you could see, train load data, I'm loading it in front of you. Cool. Now, I want everyone to do this. People who even do not know how to run a Python code can run it in Colab. Colab doesn't require any command prompt, right? So please do it. Run this cell and upload train load loan data.csv file. If data loading is complete, you would tell me data uploaded. If data loading is complete, you will tell me data uploaded. Okay, so don't get over the fact that I'm not able to run. That's not important. So everybody should be able to run the code. So it's not important, no, because your background is either you are a student who has not done coding at all. So in that case, you're supposed to actually watch the 2 hours webinar so that you come to know how this whole coding happens. If you imagine, if you wanted to go for swimming, you directly go and jump in the water? No, right? You first watch a coach, how is he swimming? You watch the instructor, wo swimming kaise kar raha hai. You don't just go and jump into the swimming pool. You keep watching him for maybe an hour or two and then you understand the steps, you do some exercise, and then you jump into the water. So same way, if this is your first or second experience and you actually have no idea of how to code, then don't expect that you should be able to code so fast. Then the whole of India would become data scientists, isn't it? And we should be exporters of data scientists. That's not the case. So never apply shortcuts to things. Give it time. So if you're not able to code along, no problems. You should be able to at least understand what is happening. That is important. Not able to even understand it, that means that you probably need to have a kind of a coding background. So you need to probably contact our learner coaches who who can actually help you. You know, that is Nisha Gaba or Kritika Shani, and they're going to actually help you out. Okay, how, what all you need to do to actually get acquainted to programming skills or coding skills. Right, so moving on to this, what I'm doing next is I'm loading my data. Read CSV means I'm reading my data into my Colab. Scene.head is going to show me first five records of my data. Wow, so I've got the gender of the person, I've got the person is married or not, how many dependents the person has, what is education qualification, like graduate, postgraduate, doctorate, not graduate. Four options. Self-employed, if you say no, that means he's a salaried person. And if he says yes, that means he's a self-employed person. Applicant income, you'll say this income seems to be too small, or this income is specified to us in dollars, $5849, $4583, etc., etc. Co-applicant income means, if husband and wife are applying for a loan. So wife becomes a co-applicant. Husband is the first holder, if applying for a loan, and makes the wife as a second holder, so it becomes a co-applicant. So if the husband is earning $4583, wife is earning $15,800, so you'll be able to apply for more amount of loan. Okay? Etc. etc. So this data is given to us. Okay, credit history is 1 or it can be 0. It can be 1 or it can be 0. Loan status, yes means loan can be given, and no means loan cannot be given, where no here means loan is rejected and why means yes, loan is given. Okay, now with this information given to us, train.shape will check how much data is there here. It's a very small data set. It is having only 614 rows and 13 columns. As you could see the columns above, 13 columns. Now what we are doing, friends, is see, when it comes to machine learning, no, machine learning does not understand text or text-based data like gender is male or female, married or not married. It doesn't understand all this yes, no, and male or female. No, it doesn't understand all this stuff. So what we're doing, we are converting. We are mapping, that means we are converting the text data into numeric data. So male converted to 0, female converted to 1. Same for married, not married is 0, married yes is 1. Similarly for loan status. Okay, this is important. This step is super important. This is called your data pre-processing your data. Okay, so after pre-processing my data, I ran my cell. How do I run my cell? I click on the run button, or you can say control enter. Either you click on the run button here or you say control enter. Okay. Next, cell of mine is train dot is null dot sum. One more thing. I think my application of Uber pickups is still running in the background, which is not correct actually, but it's consuming resources and makes a PC slow. So I'll just control C and stop that Uber pickups wala. Yeah, now train.isNull.sum is a way to check that do I have null values? I'm asking myself, do I have null values? Yes, you do. Like 13 records don't have gender value. 15 records don't have dependence value. 22 records don't have loan amount value. So on and so forth. Now this number is too small actually, 13 and then 15. So what you could do simple is you can say train.dropNA, drop all those records which have even one null value. I repeat, drop those records which have at least one null value. Notice kijiye dosto, after dropping all those records which have one null value, you said train is null dot sum, and you can see all the values are zero. As you can see, all values zero here. Okay, what is zero? Zero means there is no null value now, because all records which have null values have got dropped. So it's but obvious na, ki total number of records kam ho gaye fir. Yes, total number of records definitely would have got reduced. total number of records have got reduced from 614. I have come down to 480 entries only, but that's okay. That's okay. My objective is not to make a beautiful ML learning model. Probably we could have a bootcamp for that sometime separate, or probably you could join in with the ML or the advanced ML courses which we are running. But objective now is that whatever ML model you have been able to make, can you show it to the reporting manager? Can you show it to your colleague? Can you show it to your boss, to your teacher, in a simple web application manner? That means, can you deploy it, is the question. And yes, we can. So train.shape is showing me that I've got an entry of 480 records right now. Now friends, we are having 13 columns, right? But all 13 columns are not going to be useful. So if you do a little introspection in your mind, if you, speak to yourself, ask yourself, do I need all the columns to find whether the person's loan is, person, should I give the loan to the person or not? Honestly, not. You need to know the gender. Person is married or not. You will ask him why you want to know the person is married or not. See, when you are married, no, you have more expenditures. Please understand. Married means you're going to have a family. So you have dependents. You have children who are not earning. So obviously, if I have a loan to a married person, I have to take care of that aspect also. Because I understand that as a banker, I understand that he's going to have more commitments, more expenditure commitments. Applicant income is the super important thing. How much loan you're asking is super important thing. Imagine if your income is 25,000 rupees a month. You are a fresher. You started working in a company called TCS or a company called Accenture, and they have paid you 3,50,000 or a 3,30,000 package per year. So you are probably earning like 25,000-26,000 rupees after taxes. So in this situation, if you are actually making 25,000 rupees a month net income, and you want a loan of 3 crores to buy a property in Bombay, boss, I don't think so you can actually pay back. It's common sense. 25,000 rupees you're earning right now. How much of a growth you have in life? It will take 35-40 years to cover up a loan of 3 crores. So your EMI is going to be more than the applicant income. So this is a case where I'm going to reject. Second case, you are earning 25,000 rupees a month. You've applied for a loan of just 20,000 rupees. Wow. Instantly, you should get the loan. Hold on. You have a bad credit history. Your credit history is bad. You have unpaid loans, defaulted in the past. Still, the bank should give you another loan? Bank is not a fool to do that. So, your credit history is important in that case. Okay. Therefore, we are taking 5 columns only. Next. I'm taking these 5 columns, dumping it into my feature set, capital X is set of features. Sorry. And loan status is the only column which I'm dumping in the target variable Y. So I divided my data into 2 parts. This is the input. X means the input. Y means the output. Let me check the shape of both the data. Cool. 480 records, 480 outcomes. Perfect. Now I have reached to this point where my data preparation is done. I'm waiting for all of you to run all cells up to this point. And I will not trust you if you see me done. Huh? No. You have to punch me your answer. Like I got an answer 480,5. You have to punch me your answer also. Yeah, please continue punching your answer so that I can have full faith that yes, people who are coding along with me are really coding along. And people who are following, of course, are following. Okay. So that's so many people who are saying that they have got similar answers. That's very good. Your data preparations phase is over. data preparation phase is over. That means ML step 1, 2, 3. Step 1, you read my LinkedIn post, right? Step 1 is over. Let's come on to step 2, friends. In my step 2, I'm splitting my data into train and test split. You know, usually when you make an ML model, for people who are absolutely new to machine learning, when you make an ML model, friends, that's a good practice to split the data into two parts, that is training and test, that is testing. By giving a test size of 0.2, that is 20%, we are saying that we are keeping 20% data for testing and the rest 80% data for training our model. I'm running my this particular cell, data two part mein split ho gaya. Some part gone for training, some part gone for testing. You want to see how much part has gone for training? 384 records, notice. 384 records have come for training. And what's come for testing? 96 records have come for testing purpose. Now friends, there are many kinds of classifiers to classify. You know, what does a classifier means? Okay, just to avoid confusion, I'll just show you a graph over here, classifier and machine learning. You know, whenever I have to teach my machine learning things or my data science, I don't take too much of, you know, I don't struggle ki mujhe kya aapko dikhana. I'll just probably go to Google, type it and show you an image, because images are very easy to learn. You know, they speak a lot. Have a look at this example. So what is this indicating to you? It indicates to you a classification where, let's say this class A are all those people who are diabetic. Green are those people who are not diabetic. So you probably did a sugar test or a urine test for, let's say, 100 patients, and you got them divided into two parts like this. So what you did was, and you called a doctor, you asked the doctor, "Doctor, listen, all these patients are coming in the first upper lower half. That means their X value is low and their Y value is on the upper side. So these are people are like," the doctor says, "Okay, these are people are having low sugar level, X-axis, low sugar level, and they are quite, energetic. They are like, they're quite active in their daily routines. So these people don't have diabetes." So you say class A, non-diabetic, and class B, diabetic because they're having high sugar level, kind of, you know, so, or maybe COVID positive, not COVID positive, SA. So this is what classification does. Similarly, for classification, it can also say, no, people who will get loans and not get loans. So what a classifier does for friends is it finds something called as a best fit line. What a classifier does is it finds a best fit line or a best separating line between the two classes. This is what it is doing. So having said this, that it is able to classify, then the random forest. So there are many classifiers. Random forest classifier is one of them. Of course, time doesn't permit, and this is not the right occasion to explain to you how a classifier or how a machine learning works. There are so many parameters to it. This probably takes me usually about 1 to 2 hours to explain. Okay. So random forest classifier actually has got made, and it has got trained over the data. Fit means it is learning the data. And when it learns the data, it knows what kind of people will be accepted and what kind of people would be rejected. Okay, moving further. Now, what I'm doing, friends, is I'm actually trying to look at the accuracy score, which I'm asking the model, can you predict on XCV? Remember, XCV is holding, why should I ask you? How many records XCV is holding? Come on, anybody. What percentage of record XCV is holding? What is the percentage? Please tell me. No, Akshay, 96 records correct, but what is the percentage? Total mein se kitna hissa is XCV data test data set ka hai? 20%. Correct, everyone. Very good. 20% data, but jab aapne predict kiya is model ko, the model is giving an accuracy score of 80.2%. 80.2%. Now I want all of you to please punch me. What is your accuracy score? Come on, it's your turn now. Tell me, what is your accuracy score? Anybody who has got stuck somewhere, I can see majority of people are punching their outputs and majority of people are getting like about 80%. That's very good. Fantastic. Right. So friends, you can skip certain steps. That's not needed really. You know what I'm doing? I'm repeating the steps of loading my test loan data. Listen to me carefully. You need not do this. Ye aapko karne ki zarurat nahi hai. Then what I'm doing, I applied the same steps to my test data. You know why I have done all this stuff? I have done all this stuff so that I can check once again, is my model really working well? Is my model really working well on the test data? You say, abhi testing kiya na apne upar? No, waisa nahi hai, friends. See, what has happened is, I first took my train data, divided into two parts, 80% for training and 20% for testing, as you all people told me. And of this 20% testing, all of you have reported your accuracy also. Now, usually when we apply a machine learning model, the data entirely gets divided into, actually, frankly speaking, into three parts. First is training. Second is validation. So to be very honest, this 20% data over which accuracy has got reported is the validation data. And the third part is the testing data, which is a complete separate data set. This is a complete separate data set. This data is of course very similar to the train data, but this is like new data which is given to you. So you know, your banker, your IT manager in the bank is saying you that, listen boss, I'm giving you the train data. You consume 80% of the train data for training your model, 20% of the data for validating your model, and if you get more than 80% accuracy, get to work. Your boss says, if you get more than 80% accuracy, please get to work. Get to work ka matlab, sir, main kaam hi kar raha tha roz. Nahi, waisa matlab nahi. Mera matlab ye hai ki 80% agar aapko accuracy aaya, ya jyada aaya 80% se, to aap apne model ko actual data lo, take new data and start testing it. And then whatever predictions you get on it, accordingly take a decision whether you should give a loan to those customers or you should not give a loan. Okay. So this step is like testing on the test data is optional. For this workshop, ML123 is optional, but not in reality. In reality, it is needed. So I've given you all the steps for your self-execution. Right now, at this line of code, when you reported to me the accuracy, hold on, let me scroll a bit up. Yes, see, at this step, when you reported to me the accuracy of the model, remember your model is ready. Your model is ready. Okay, so I'm scrolling a bit. Please see carefully. Yes, see this, what I have done. I'm saving the model into a file called classify.pickle. Any file name can be given, but the extension should be PKL. PKL stands for pickle file, where pickle file basically means it's a binary file. Okay, so you're saving your model as a pickle file. So I'm opening the file, I'm dumping. Dumping means you're saving the pickle. Okay, you're saving the pickle. Wow, your pickle has got saved. You ask Rocky, what is the proof pickle has got saved? Well, the proof is here. Please see. You know, so I just opened my folder. On the right side, I can see the pickle file has got saved. See, I've got the pickle file here. Okay, now I want all of you to come to this cell called saving the model. Okay, and save, run this code and tell me that in your folder path, do you see a pickle file? In your folder path, do you see a pickle file? Very good. Very good. I'm very happy. Usually in a webinar, see in a bootcamp or workshop, which are like, you know, paid workshops or paid bootcamps or probably our courses, everyone has to execute. I make sure everyone has to execute in my courses. In bootcamps, about 70-80% people execute. In webinars, usually 25-30% people execute. But I'm very happy. This is more than 25-30% people who are executing in this webinar. That's very good. Right? Because webinar is basically kind of enlightenment session where you get an overview of the subject. Okay, how things work. I'm very happy. So many people are executing simultaneously. Cool. Right, you got a pickle file. Now, don't run immediately after me. Just follow me. Please just follow me. See what I'm doing next. I've gone to the repository, which I've already given you. And there are two files here. App loan predictor and loan predicting model. Let me open both the files. Please only follow, don't run now. Okay, how much of an expert you are, you'll probably get stuck. So follow me first. Friends, this code file, loan predicting model.py, has the following steps which you just executed right now. Jo steps aapne abhi execute kiya, sare ke sare steps isme hai. First, it is loading the data. Then it is doing the work of data pre-processing, then work of data cleaning, separating the features X and the target variable Y. Further, doing a train test split, then making a random forest classifier object, that is ML model object, asking the ML model to fit means learn the data. Then I'm opening a file called classify.pickle. I'm dumping, dump is a method which is imported from joblib library. I'm dumping the model, that means I'm saving the model into the classify.pickle. Cool. And last I'm printing model saved as pickle, file named classify.pickle. I'm going to run this code. Please only follow me, don't run. Neither after me nor along with me. Please don't run, because you will have to change all these paths. And if you do keep doing these things, you will miss what I'm trying to say. So let me try running this code, friends. So just set the path correct. But I know you will say me. अरे रॉकी जी वो क्लासिफाइड और पिकल फाइल तो हमारे पास ऑलरेडी है. हाँ है, करेक्ट है, बट आई हैव टू रन द कोड एंड शो यू नो दैट द कोड कैन ऑल्सो रन. अदरवाइज हाउ विल यू ट्रस्ट द कोड इज रनिंग ऑर नॉट. सेम कोड विच यू रन इन कोलैब. आई एम रनिंग द सेम कोड नाउ ऑन अ पाइथन कमांड प्रॉम्प्ट. प्लीज हैव अ केयरफुल लुक. सी इट गेव मी ऑल द आउटपुट्स. इट इज स्टिल रनिंग. पेशेंस. And oh wow, it says model saved as pickle file named classify.pickle. That means I should have got a new pickle file in my repository. Yes, I did. Wow, see this. Today's date, 8th August, 7:58 PM. I've got a classify.pickle file in place. Absolutely. Wow, it ran. Correct. Great. Next, what? So you have a pickle file in place, huh? Now what? Now there is another file called app loan predictor.py. where all the coding of Streamlit has been done. As you can notice, import Streamlit as ST. Import Streamlit as ST. So this is straightforward coding, nothing big about it. So we are first opening and loading the classify.pickle file. We are first loading the machine learning model. Once we load the machine learning model, then we have defined a function called prediction, to which we are passing some parameters. So we're just trying to check, is gender equal to male? Is married equal to unmarried? So just trying to set, you know, married equal to unmarried, so married ko zero kar do, otherwise one kar do. Straightforward if else code. Then what we're doing? The classifier which you made, already trained ML model, you are asking him to predict that if I give you so and so gender, marriage status, applicant income, loan amount, credit history, then please tell me what is the prediction. If the classifier returns to me a prediction as zero, means the loan is rejected. And if the classifier returns to me a prediction as one, that means loan is approved. Okay, right? Now I'm going to run this code. Ab main ye wala code run karunga. But please remember, friends, this is a Streamlit code. Don't forget, huh? You have to run it by using Streamlit run. So again, I'm taking the path of this. I've taken the path of this. So in ML Streamlit testing app, loan predictor. I'm running it, everything in front of you. So please have a look. I'm not pre-running anything. Streamlit run. Aapke file ka path. Patience rakhiye. 30 seconds rukiye. Great. Kehta hai localhost 8501 par aapka Streamlit application web app has started. Let's see. It has really started. Let's go there. Oh wow, it did. It's really started. Yes, that's honest. See this. It looks nice, right? Streamlit loan prediction ML application. Choose gender, male, female, married, unmarried status, applicant income. This is actually plus minus. That is not coming because of the browser. I told you the browser key problem. So you can enter the applicant income. What is the applicant income? What, 1 lakh, 10,000, whatever you want to enter. Let's say 1 lakh. And this is loan amount. Okay, how much loan do we want? Let's say we want a personal loan of 50,000. And 1 lakh is the income. 50,000 is the loan expected. So there are two options here. Unclear debts and no unclear debts. Unclear debts means 1. No unclear debts means 0. So no unclear debts means there is no unclear debts. So everything is like cool. It's cleared. Let's see what the prediction says. Prediction says your loan is approved. So no human intervention. A simple web application made. You enter your details. You can take n number of more details, no? Right? For the demonstration purpose, we have taken some details. You can take much more details. ML model will get trained. And more details if you give him, he's going to get trained. And it's going to give you an answer whether a loan is approved or not. Now think it this way. Your income is 10,000. You want loan of 5 lakhs. Okay. And in such situations, you think you are not going to have debts. Yes, I think you will have some debts in the past if this is a situation. Income 10,000. Loan you want 5 lakhs. So do you have unclear debts? Yes, you do. CC predict what he says. He says clear cut, your loan is rejected. Okay, right? So now, friends, I hope this whole idea of the ML 123 webinar or workshop, whatever we call it as, was useful. Okay, and you now know that post the session, how you're going to run these two applications. Now let me come on to, I need at least more 5 more minutes for with all of you. So a quick question to all of you. See, we will not know how many people have attended the session now, you know. So all the people who are right now on the session. Please remain intact there and answer a quick question of mine. And I would request Nisha Gaba to please take a count of as well as the names of all those people who are right now on the group. Nisha Gaba, I'll talk further with the next instruction once you have finished with taking a count of the people. Count means I want to have the list of the names of the people. Perfect. Right. So do you have the list with you? Nisha Gaba, can you come on audio and answer to me? Taken their names. Fantastic. Okay. Now a quick question to everyone. Have you all filled up? Have you all filled up at least once the Google form? Is there anybody who is right now live who has not filled the Google form at all? Google form of Swing Consultants. Great. So you have filled the Google form at least once. Anybody who is not filled in, I would humbly request post the session to immediately connect with your learner coach, either with Nisha Gaba or with Kritika. I repeat, if you have not filled in the Google form, or if you like vaguely remember, maybe filled it somewhere else, you're feeling you filled at Swing Consultants, please connect with Nisha Gaba or with Kritika immediately and request them. They will give you the Google form and you can fill it. Okay? Right. Cool. Now, I hope you got the whole intuition very clear. Friends, probably in the next 2 or 3 days, our team is going to mail you the certificate of participation to this Streamlit. But I would love more than the certificate which comes to you, or more than my webinar. I would love to know your experience. If you know a little bit of ML, you could think of making some other application and actually making a Streamlit app and sharing that link when you're making a LinkedIn post to share your experience about this workshop. Please do share your experience of this workshop. And if you have not made your application, you're absolutely welcome to share our links there. You can share our links. You can just guide the people to go to datascience.swinconsultants.com and go down to the section called ML, and under the ML section, so the workspace content is here. So anybody who is like listening to a LinkedIn post or seeing a LinkedIn post knows from where he or she can get the resources. And otherwise, you know what is going to happen? They will ping you. Ki tune kahan se kiya? Aapne kahan se kiya? Mujhe resources de. So why you want to take the headache? Tell them these resources are available here. Simple. And I'm going to send you the video recorded session. So you will have that as well. Right? So friends, I thank you all for coming in for the ML 123 and learning how data preparation, data, making of the ML model from the data and deployment with Streamlit completely happens.